Well, good morning. Hope that you are having a great Christmas weekend. Not sure when you're watching this, but we are looking forward to Christmas Eve tomorrow night here at the church, and then this will be aired on Sunday. And we are in a series called Emmanuel, God with Us. And we've been looking at several different scripture passages, looking at some old prophecies about the coming of Christ. And I hope that this has been an encouragement to you. And our hope has really just been for us to lift our eyes and focus on Christ, as we do every Christmas, of course. But we've looked at, the shepherds, and we've looked at Mary and Joseph's faith, and then the old prophecy out of Isaiah. And today what I want to do is I want to look at Simeon. And this is in Luke chapter 2. And it's kind of a long passage today, so I'm not going to read the whole thing in one chunk, but I want to just kind of go through it and highlight some things along the way. But if you have a Bible there, you can get it out or turn it on to Luke chapter 2, and then we are going to start in verse 21. So Luke 2:21, and it says this: At the end of 8 days, when he was circumcised, he was called Jesus, given his name, the name given by the angel before he was conceived in the womb. And then verse 22. And when the time came for their purification, according to the law of Moses, they brought him up to Jerusalem to present him to the Lord. As it is written in the law of the Lord, every male who first opens the womb shall be called holy to the Lord. So this is the time of the purifications. This is 40 days after Jesus' birth, and this is 8 days, it says here, of the circumcision, but then you add the 33 days of Leviticus 12 for the consecration of the firstborn, and that's where we get the 40 days from. And it says in verse 24, to offer a sacrifice according to what is said in the law of the Lord, a pair of turtle doves and two young pigeons. You might be saying, like, what in the world are we even talking about here? This was the offering that would be given when your newborn was consecrated, and especially the firstborn son was consecrated, given over to the Lord. And this pair of turtle doves and pigeons shows us, as you may have heard, that Joseph and Mary were very poor. They didn't have much. This was like the lowest class of sacrifice you could give if you didn't have much money. And the more well-to-do, or the people that had more resources, would offer a lamb at this point, and they can only do two young pigeons or two turtle doves. And so this just kind of showed their status. We know this, Jesus was born into a poor family. But what I want to focus on today is not that poverty as much, but I want to look at what Simeon says. He's an interesting character here in the story, and we've just celebrated Christmas. And so now this is kind of the next event in the Luke telling of the story that happens here as they come to the temple. So they'd gone to offer sacrifice and to present Jesus to Jerusalem at the temple. And we have this guy come on the scene named Simeon. And this is in verse 25. It says, there was a man in Jerusalem whose name was Simeon. This man was righteous and devout, waiting for the consolation of Israel. And the Holy Spirit was upon him. And it had been revealed to him by the Holy Spirit that he would not see death before he had seen the Lord's Christ. So this guy is at the temple. He lived in Jerusalem, and God told him that he was going to see the Messiah before he died. So he was waiting eagerly for this, as of course all of God's people, the Israelites, they were longing for this Messiah. But it had been revealed directly to Simeon that he would, by the Holy Spirit, he would see the Messiah. He would actually get to meet this Savior, this one that would come, that had been promised for generations, that all the prophets had spoke about, that even Genesis 3:15 promised that one day a seed of a woman would crush the head of the serpent that brought the curse into the world by tempting Adam and Eve. So all the history of Israel is culminating in this, and this one guy, Simeon, was told by God that you're going to meet him. And he's waiting for the consolation of Israel. That's another phrase that is referring to the Messiah. It's this word comfort. It's the hope that God would come and comfort and rescue his people. So, along with all of Israel, Simeon was waiting, but particularly this guy. It says in verse 27, he came in the spirit into the temple. So this is Simeon. And when the parents brought the child Jesus in to do for him according to the custom of the law, he took him up in his arms and blessed God and said, so Simeon holds his child and he knows this is the Messiah. And then we have this song. It's called the Nunc Dimittis, and it's that's Latin, but it's been sung throughout in the church throughout the ages, and recited and read and memorized. And this is it. This is in verse 29 through 32. It says this: Lord, now you are letting your servant depart in peace, according to your word. For my eyes have seen your salvation, that you have prepared in the presence of all peoples, a light for revelation to the Gentiles, and for glory to your people, Israel. And this is, it's been turned into a beautiful song, but he is praising God for being able to see and hold the Messiah in his hands. So what we're going to see is he proclaims and announces three things about Christ to Mary and Joseph about this child. Again, Jesus is just a baby at this point. And he's holding him, and in his song, and then the verses that follow, he announces and proclaims three things about the child. And in the third thing, we'll see a couple subpoints about the conflict that we'll talk about in a minute. But the first thing he says is, your child is the Messiah. My eyes have seen your salvation. Verse 31, you have prepared in the presence of all people a light for revelation to the Gentiles and for glory to your people Israel. You see, the Messiah was coming for Israel, and it had been promised to Israel, but God's intention was always to bless the whole earth. Remember the promise to Abraham? Back in Genesis 12, it was Abram at the time before he's renamed. And he says, in your family, through your family, all the families of the earth will be blessed. All the nations will be blessed. God chose Abram and Abraham to become Father Abraham, that had many sons, right? The father of Israel. But even in that promise, it wasn't just for this nation. It was so that the gospel would go out to the entire earth, that the Messiah would come for all people, anybody who would believe. So first thing is pretty straightforward. It's huge, though. Imagine as a parent going, and you've heard, again, this birth has been announced. Angels have appeared in a dream to Joseph and then to Mary, and the shepherds have sung. All this stuff is going on, and they're like, what? You know, wait a minute. My kid is going to be that? He's going to do that? He's going to accomplish that? It's got to be mind-boggling for them to think, is this really going to happen like this? God made these promises. We know we can trust him, but how? How can a child be the Savior? How can the sins of the world be dealt with through our kid? Like, just imagine as a parent. Now you've got this guy in the temple, grabs your kid, and he's just, I've been waiting. God told me I would get to meet the Messiah. They're like, Messiah, oh yeah. And he's holding him, and he says, your child is the Lord's Christ. This is the name of the Messiah. This is back in verse 26. The Holy Spirit told Simeon, revealed to him, that he would not see death before he had seen the Lord's Christ. This is God's Messiah. Remember, Jesus Christ isn't a name like a first name and a last name. It's a title. Christ is Messiah. That's not just Jesus' last name. So first thing, your child is the Messiah. The second thing he said in here, we already read it, but in verse 32 says, a light for revelation to the Gentiles and for glory to your people Israel. And so not only is your child the Messiah, Joseph and Mary, this baby I'm holding, but also your child has come to bring salvation to all who will believe. So Messiah has come to rescue, but this salvation is a light to the Gentiles, and it says here, the glory of your people, or to your people Israel. Acts 26, verse 17. This is Paul speaking, and he says, delivering you from your people and from the Gentiles to whom I am sending you to open their eyes. This is God speaking through Paul. He's kind of recounting his salvation story as he testifies, as he goes through, as seeking to end up in Rome. But he says, to open their eyes so that they may turn from darkness to light, from the power of Satan to God, that they may receive forgiveness of sins and a place among those who are sanctified by me in faith. So this is Paul being delivered so that he can take this message out to your people and the Gentiles. So the message starts with Israel, and then it goes out to the rest of the world. This salvation this baby that Simeon is holding in the temple and they're getting ready to dedicate him is going to bring salvation. Imagine again, as a parent, you're looking at your kid going, what, how in the world is this possible? God is so good. Luke 19:10 says, the Son of Man, that's Jesus, came to seek and save the lost. This is the great purpose that Christ came to fulfill. Isaiah 49:6 says this. He says, it is too light a thing that you should be, that you should be my servant to raise up the tribes of Jacob, to bring back the preserved of Israel. I will make you as a light for the nations, that my salvation may reach the end of the earth. You see, God had chosen Israel to display his glory and to show these are my people, but they were to take that good news of God's love to the world. That's why it's called the glory of Israel. God has given the Messiah to Israel so that they could proclaim it, just like he has for us, the church. We know the gospel so that we can take it out. It doesn't rest on us like, oh, thank you for doing that for me, God. That's the end of the story. But that's just the beginning. God has saved you, if you're a Christian, so that you can go out and be a light to the rest of the world, just like it said in Isaiah 49. Hebrews 1:1-3 describes Jesus coming on the scene in this way. Long ago, at many times and in many ways, God spoke to our fathers by the prophets. So it's saying God has spoken over the years through the prophets. But in these last days, he has spoken to us by his Son. Again, this is the baby that they're holding, whom he appointed the heir of all things, through whom he also created the world. He is the radiance of the glory of God, the exact imprint of his nature, and he upholds the universe by the word of his power. So this baby has come on the scene into the world so that God could speak to us through his Son. Jesus came so that all these prophecies would be fulfilled, and he came and spoke and lived and walked among us and laid his life down so that this salvation could be accomplished. Almost all the celebrations at Christmas focus entirely on this good gift, and they should, to some degree, of course, on the sweetness and light. Christ came to bring peace on earth, goodwill toward men. But it's not that simple. That's not the whole story. That's not the full story. Because we're going to see that this child is, again, the Messiah, but he's also coming to bring salvation to anybody who would believe. But think about this. How does peace come? Think about a surgeon, for example. How does if you have a tumor, how does a surgeon bring peace to your body? They cut it out. What about a therapist? If someone is downcast and depressed and really struggling, they bring up the terrible feelings and confront the painful memories or the issues, and it hurts in order to move beyond that and to get to that place of peace. Both a surgeon and a therapist, and we could probably think of other examples too, they make you feel worse before you feel better. Listen to this quote. One of the unfortunate realities of our modern Christmas commemorations or celebrations is the reduction of Christ's birth to a sweet, sentimental story of a tiny baby wrapped in swaddling clothes, lowing cattle, and gentle shepherds. But the advent, remember the coming, of our Lord was anything but sappy. It was incredibly subversive. Mary prophesied her child would scatter the proud, bring down the mighty from their thrones, and send the rich away empty-handed. The psalmist proclaims that he will defend the cause of the poor, give deliverance to the needy, and crush the oppressor. Maybe that's why Herod wanted him killed. This Christ child we worship didn't merely come into the world to reign in our hearts, but to inaugurate his kingdom come and his will done on earth as it is in heaven. The gospel writers understood this better than anybody. At the time of Jesus' birth, there was already a man who was called Divine Son of God and God from God. His title was Lord, Redeemer, Liberator, and Savior of the world. You may remember this if you were here for our Colossians study, but his name was Caesar Augustus. So that's what the Roman people referred to Caesar as. He was praised as a god. To give titles to Jesus, these titles, was thereby, and it had to be, to deny them of Caesar. So to call Jesus the Redeemer would mean that the only redeemer would mean that Caesar can't be the redeemer anymore. So that was either a strange coincidence or it's what the Romans called high treason. This language of Simeon here places Jesus in direct opposition to any political power claiming our allegiance then and now. Simply put, Jesus is Lord and Caesar is not. Proclaiming that is dangerous even today. So as you celebrate Christmas with your family, last part of this quote here, remember there's more to the sweet story than meets the eye. The rightful king arrived meek and lowly to put the powers that be on notice. Rome's imperial politic of power was replaced with the kingdom politics of love. As citizens in this kingdom, our lives are now reoriented around a new administration, a new constitution, a new way of living. So if you want to keep Christ in Christmas, there's no better way to do it than feeding the hungry, clothing the naked, welcoming the foreigner, caring for the poor, loving your enemies, and doing to others what you would have them do unto you. Then there will be peace on earth and goodwill toward men. That was a little long, but it's important to remember when Jesus, this baby, comes onto the scene, it's the inauguration of a new kingdom. And this king not only is to be worshiped and glorified, but he is going to change the way that we look at the world. So if you're a Christian, you know this. Jesus has come into your life and he's radically reoriented things. You're no longer the boss. You're no longer the king. You're no longer in charge. But he is. And we have to bow down to him and worship him in this way, even as Simeon holds his child. And that's kind of what he continues to say. He said all these beautiful things. You're letting me depart in peace according to your word. My eyes have seen your salvation. So it's this glorious beauty of Christmas. But the last thing Simeon tells them is that your child will bring peace, but he'll do it through conflict. So your child's a Messiah. He comes to bring, he's going to bring salvation, and he will bring peace through conflict. So look back at our passage, Luke 2, verse 33. The response is just like what Mary, kind of the way Mary responded. She marveled, she wondered, she's like, how can this be as Gabriel came to her? Verse 33, his father and his mother, Joseph and Mary, marveled at what was said about him. They're like, whoa. You know, again, they're saying, no way. Marveled means like, it's not like they're like, oh, that's interesting. But they were blown away, like, how can this be? How can a child accomplish all that? Is it really possible that he's the Messiah, that he's coming to bring all this salvation, the glory of your people Israel? So they were stunned by this song, this kind of poetic saying that Simeon gives. They're blown away by it. But then he continues. Verse 34. It says, Simeon blessed them and said to Mary, his mother. So now he turns to Mary. They're both standing there still, and we think he's still holding the baby. I'm pretty sure. He says, behold, this child is appointed for the fall and rising of many in Israel, and for a sign that is opposed, and a sword will pierce through your own soul also, so that thoughts from many hearts may be revealed. So the first thing, we see Jesus, he says, this child is going to bring conflict, but peace will come through that conflict. So the first thing he comes to divide is people. So there's conflict in the world. It says the rise and fall. There's no doubt here in Simeon's message. He's not just saying this is a glorious child, but he says Jesus has come to redeem, to be the comfort, the redemption, the consolation, but he has come to bring peace on earth. But that peace comes through being confronted with some amazing claims. And we see this throughout Jesus' life as he starts his ministry. He's not just walking around just healing and being kind to children, although he does those things, not just casting demons out, but he also confronts religious leaders and he teaches truth in a way that offends many, many people. And he doesn't do it for the sake of being offensive, but the truth by nature is often that way. Think about this. When you became a Christian, if you're a follower of Jesus, when you first understood that you needed forgiveness, you had to admit something, right? You had to admit that I'm a sinful person. I have a problem here. And it's not just like a problem like, oh, my car's not running right. But this is a devastating, like soul-destroying problem. I can't do anything about my sin. I need Jesus' forgiveness to deal with that. And so this message is by nature offensive. John 3:16, one of our favorite verses, for God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, or his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. But keep reading. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him. Whoever believes in him is not condemned, but whoever does not believe is condemned already, because he has not believed in the name of the only Son of God. See, Jesus comes and there's a choice to make. He comes on the scene and it's not like, oh, that's a neat story about a baby and the virgin birth and all the angels and shepherds and, oh, it's a beautiful story. It is a beautiful story. But he comes and he says, you have a choice to make. You must believe or not believe. There's no middle ground. And there are some people that are still kind of investigating and thinking about Christianity. They're on their way to belief maybe, but we're forced to make a choice. Jesus demands allegiance. When he said, deny yourself, take up your cross and follow me. You can't follow yourself and follow Jesus. You can't follow someone else and follow Jesus. You have a choice to make. He said, I'm the way, the truth, and the life, right? No one comes to the Father except through me. He's staking a claim on the universe saying, mine. And how can this not be offensive and seem arrogant and seem even bigoted? Is it really true that there's only one way to God? Jesus said, absolutely. And it's the most loving possible thing to do. It's not arrogant. It's not bigoted. If it's true, it's the message we have to get out. Some people don't know that. And they desperately need forgiveness and they cannot have it without Christ. Jesus said this in Matthew chapter 10. Do not think that I have come to bring peace to the earth. Like, wait a minute. I thought the message of Christmas was peace on earth, goodwill toward men. Well, he qualifies it. I have not come to bring peace, but a sword. I've come to set a man against his father and a daughter against her mother and a daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law. Whoever finds his life will lose it, and whoever loses his life for my sake will find it. Jesus is coming to bring peace, not among people, but he's coming to bring peace with God to make that possible. See, in Romans 5, it describes us as being reconciled to God when we come to faith. But before that, we were enemies of God. So that's the peace he comes to bring. He doesn't come to make relationships easy for us or to somehow fix our relational issues in our family, right? We just celebrated Christmas. So some of you have a great time with your family. Sometimes you're struggling families, right? We're all messed up, so we make mistakes and offend each other and whatnot. Jesus didn't come to just make life easy, but he came to give us peace with God so that we could have forgiveness. And then our lives of love will flow out of that. Jesus is not talking about, when he says, I've not come to bring peace but a sword, he's not talking about inciting violence or some kind of weird, you know, militaristic attitude. But his call to allegiance brings conflict. Jesus makes people mad sometimes, and he often causes struggle and strife. Think about this. Just living an honest, moral life will expose things like gossip around your workplace or in your home with your friends. As a Christian, you'll say, you know, I really can't be a part of that. That's not the way we talk about people. It'll expose corruption in business or in government or whatever. It'll expose racism in the neighborhood or whatever. And so as we live our lives, for Jesus, as we live them in allegiance to him, we will have to choose his side over other sides and other issues very often. Doesn't mean we walk around with a chip on our shoulder and are somehow looking for trouble. But as I follow Christ, it's going to make me different from other people in the world that aren't following Christ. And some people aren't going to like that. The manger at Christmas means that if you live like Jesus, there won't be room for you in a lot of inns. That's a quote out of from Tim Keller. I thought that was great. It leaves nobody alone. It could, you know, potentially polarize you. The reason he polarized people, the reason Jesus made these claims, is because they were true. So if Simeon is right, Jesus will cause you either to run away from him or be drawn to him by his attractive love. It says the rising and falling of many, the fall and rising of many in Israel. And we saw this in Jesus' life. Who was it at first that turned against him? Well, it was mainly the religious leaders that didn't like him. They were waiting for a Messiah too, but they didn't like the way Jesus taught. And they started early on to plot to destroy him, to get rid of him, because they didn't like the message he was giving. So there are many in our world who just flat out hate God openly. Most people are more indifferent, right? There are many who live with Jesus as their king. But most people are just kind of waffling back and forth. They don't know the real Jesus yet. So we need to seek to explain to people this king. And Christmas, again, is a great time to do this. So Simeon is telling Mary and Joseph, behold, this child is appointed for the fall and rising of many in Israel and for a sign that is opposed. So let's look at verse 35. Let's keep going in our passage here. We already read it, but it says, and a sword will pierce through your own soul also, so that thoughts from many hearts may be revealed. So Jesus not only causes conflict in the world, right? It said mother and father and brother and sister might be against each other. So someone comes to faith in a family and they say, you know what, I can't live like this anymore. And the other people in the family are like, what's wrong with you? You may have experienced this in your family. Like, what are you doing? But he causes conflict in the heart. And in the soul, it says a sword will pierce through your own soul also, and thoughts from many hearts may be revealed or exposed. So Mary is going to have a lot of pain in her life. And we see this. She didn't know this. Simeon's holding the baby. They're presenting him in the temple. She had no idea what was coming. She knew that all these great promises were coming to fruition through her son, and that all these promises of salvation and the Messiah. And she's thinking, well, but she didn't know all the trouble that would come her way, especially, obviously, this is certainly, we think, a reference to the sword that would pierce Jesus on the cross while she would have to watch her son be murdered by this ruthless mob of angry Jewish people asking the Romans to kill him, to mete out this ridiculous punishment over what he had allegedly done. But Mary actually stands as a representative of all humans. Basically, if you love him, if you stand by him, a sword will pass through your soul as well. Think of coming to faith. I already alluded to Jesus saying, deny yourself, take up your cross, and follow me. When you become a Christian, you have a new king, right? King Jesus instead of King Matt or you, right? You're no longer in charge. You're bowing the knee. You go from the kingdom of darkness to the kingdom of light, the ultimate peace that's even possible. You're no longer an enemy of God. Now you're a friend of God. But it only comes through realizing that you're in desperate need of forgiveness. And there's nothing you can do. Peace comes through that conflict. The way to God is to realize I'm in big trouble, as we mentioned before. And while it's only temporary, the Christian life has conflict. The three major enemies we have are self, sin, and the devil, right? And with God's grace and help, we battle this. Romans 6 and 7, the Apostle Paul wrote a bunch about this, saying, I don't do the things that I want to do sometimes. And sometimes I do the things I hate and don't want to do. And he says, wretched man that I am. And he says, who will deliver me from this body of death? And he says, but by the grace of God, he is pulling me through that. And he's conforming me into the image of Jesus, he says later in chapter 8. And so there's a struggle, this fight. And it's not that we have to fight and fix our lives and then come to God, but God saves us and then begins that work of transformation. But the battle is real. It's only temporary while we're still here on planet Earth, but there's conflict. But God's peace always, always comes through conflict. Think of just a couple examples. Repentance and exposure. I'm thinking of sin here, right? All you need really is nothing. But most people don't have that. Repentance is to admit that you've done all kinds of things wrong. You have a selfish, sinful heart, or maybe it's just one sin you're dealing with. And repenting is turning from that and just casting your hope on the mercy of God. Say, God, forgive me. Help me to walk away from this sin. It stings, but it heals. Grace of God washes over us as we confess our sin to him and to others. And all of life really is repenting. It's turning from our sin and turning back to God. It's just a continuous process. And thinking more practically about this, if you don't even remember the last time, if you're a follower of Jesus, that you've turned from sin and just, your heart was broken over it and you confessed it to God and ran back to him, then something is missing. You're missing out on the grace of God washing over you in that practice. So think about God's peace coming through that conflict, right? You have to battle that sin, fight against that sin, turn from it, and turn back to God, and then peace comes. There's that assurance and that just the joy that comes, man, God, thank you for your grace in my life. Thank you for helping me deal with that sin or those sins or whatever it was. So that's one example of the peace coming through conflict. Another one is just think about obedience. The road to sometimes we choose comfort, or being lazy sometimes, or just being kind of passive or whatever, versus obedience. Obedience is hard sometimes. If you're going to obey God, you're going to have less money than you would if you didn't obey God. That's just how it works. God calls us to be generous people, calls us to give of what we have, to share what we have, to show hospitality to strangers and others, and to help people. And so if you follow God, you will have less money than you would if you don't. Now, God continues to bless and even give more. Just the other day, Kevin was telling me a story about a family member that wrote a text saying, "You cannot give God. I sent a check in for X amount of dollars, and then the very next day I got even more money in the mail, $100 more than I had sent in." That's awesome when God does that. But when you think about your things and your money and maybe your home, the more you follow Christ, the less you're going to have, by and large. What about your reputation? If Christ's glory and God's honor is the highest value in your life, your reputation may suffer sometimes. Think about the people you date, for those of you that aren't married yet, or maybe you've had a spouse leave you or pass away. You will have a different dating life if you seek to obey God than if you choose the easy road, right? It's almost unheard of now for people not to sleep together before they're married. So choosing obedience in that is very difficult, to be faithful to God. The world is broken and fallen, and in the short term, obedience may hurt, but it's the way to peace, to follow God. When do you feel closest to God? When you're walking in His ways, not living some perfect life and being, you know, none of us can do that. We're not fake about it, but when we're following God and living in His will, that's when we have that peace that Christ is talking about here, Simeon's talking about through Jesus. So Simeon's message is really teaching us to look at Christmas and see the peace of God that brings goodwill to men. He says these beautiful things about Christ. But the interesting part is it's not going to come exactly like we thought. He says again, "Thank you for letting me see this child. I'm going to depart in peace according to your word, like you told me. You promised me I was going to see this baby, and here I am. My eyes see your salvation." So he's just praising God for that. But then he says, "This child is appointed for the fall and rising." So true peace comes only through Christ, the most polarizing figure in history. You can't come to Christmas. You can't come to Jesus without making a choice. Really believing the message of Christmas isn't just about this generic peace and goodwill toward men. This is peace with God that can only come through Christ. So again, when Jesus made all these claims, either he didn't leave it to us to choose whether we could say, "Oh, he was a great teacher," or "he had some great things to say," but he said, either you follow me and have forgiveness, or you don't and you have condemnation. Those who don't believe are condemned already because they have not believed in the Son of God. This is the purpose for which Jesus came. So what have you done with his claims to allegiance? Jesus says, follow me. Who's your king? It may be that you could be a person that's been watching church online, or maybe coming to church for a long time in your life, and you've never bowed the knee to King Jesus. What I mean by that is you've never just surrendered to him and said, "I need forgiveness. I need Jesus to be my king. I've tried to be my king and I can't do it. I keep messing it up. My life is never going to be fixed. I'm never going to be able to deal with sin and get forgiveness. Come to King Jesus now, today, right now. Stop this video and start praying to him. Just come before him and say, Jesus, I need you. He has come this Christmas again to bring us to God. This is why he came, and this is the message that continues. Follow him this Christmas. He humbled himself for the joy set before him," we read in Hebrews 12. He endured the cross and suffered the shame so that people, you, me, anybody who would believe, can have this peace. So through the conflict comes peace. And that's the only way that peace can come. So he's causing the rise and fall, and he's causing people to come to him and say, I need to make a choice. Do I follow Jesus, or do I keep following myself or living for something else? One ends in the life full of joy, living the way God has made us to live, and the other one ends in destruction, ruin, loneliness, separation from God, and punishment for the sins that we deserve versus Jesus offering forgiveness because he took that for us. What I'd like to do is pray for us today and just ask God to come again and bring us peace with him, and then help us to take that message out wherever we go this week. So why don't you pray with me? God, we're so grateful for this passage about Simeon. What an incredible part of the story of Christ's birth and early days. God, that you promised this man a couple thousand years ago that he would see the Messiah, that he would hold this child in his hands. God, what an incredible thing for him to have been there at the temple for the dedication and to be able to lift this child up and to proclaim this beautiful song that's sung all over the world even to this day. God, I pray that as we think about our lives, that you would help us to choose Christ, to follow the King. And God, as we surrender to him, that you would fill our lives with the joy of that incredible forgiveness, the joy of that message of grace, that we would take it out everywhere we go this week. God, thank you for this time of year where we can stop and celebrate and feast and have a great time together with friends and family. And I pray that we would go out and serve you this week as we take the message everywhere we go. I'll give you the praise for all you do. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, we are excited about a new series starting just after the turn of the year, and we'll tell you more about it later, but we're going to be looking into the Ten Commandments and looking at a series called The Ten Words. And so looking forward to sharing that with you over the weeks to come, and we will see you next week, if not before. Happy New Year. Thank you.